When you look up at the stars and realize what an insignificant speck of lint you are compared to the humongous immensity of the infinite universe, you've got to ask yourself, how much does a final paper really matter anyway?
Your paper will be worth 40% of your final grade.
I struggle a lot when starting a script. The middle part with all the information and review, that's easy. The ending is a little tricky, but I tend to get there. But actually starting one of these things usually results in me staring at a blank document for 15 minutes, half an hour, 2 hours, and when that happens, there's a sense of time shifting, of the minutes stretching longer and longer, and I'm here, trapped, looking at an empty white void. Limbo, a purgatory of my own creation. Time slows like it does on the last day of school. Eyes on your watch, counting the seconds before the final bell. Space Geeks and Johnny Unitas originally aired on June 17, 1992, and was the third of five television specials starring the characters of Pete and Pete, sibling characters played by Michael Marona and Danny Tamborelli, originating from a series of interstitial shorts in 1989 that would eventually become a full series, The Adventures of Pete and Pete, in 1993. The special was written by co-creator Will McRobb and directed by Catherine Diekman, who would direct four of the five specials and some of REM's early music videos. And not the sad, high production value music videos, but the quirky, minimalist, somewhat culty vibe stuff. I love it. It's the final week of school. Summer break is right around the corner, but Big Pete and Ellen's science teacher has given the class a final assignment, a paper that'll be worth 40% of their total grade. If they fail, they'll have to attend summer school. Big Pete gets the topic of how light waves travel through the vacuum of space, while Ellen's paper is on carbon-based materials found on planets like Mars. Pretty dull, technical stuff. But then they each cross paths with Joe Jones, a strange fellow student who mostly keeps to himself, and he's got opinions on their papers.
They called it the greatest game ever played, you know.
What?
The 1958 NFL Championship game between the Baltimore Colts and the New York Giants. First sudden death overtime game played in history. Ever heard about it?
Heard about it? It's my favorite game of all time. 7 minutes into overtime, and Johnny Unitas hands off to Alan Amitu, who takes it in from the one. Colts win 23-17.
Best game I ever saw.
Wait, how could you have seen it? It happened 34 years ago.
Of course I didn't actually see it. I just read about it in a book.
This was a real football game that really happened in 1958, and Johnny Unitas was a real football star who played in that game and just so happens to have a last name that almost sounds like Universe. Pete and Pete is a song, but all the rhymes are fuzzy. Joe Jones convinces Ellen to pivot her paper to creating a test you can use to determine if someone is secretly an alien.
Okay, maybe we should start with basic questions, like, how about this? What color is your mucus?
Subtle.
Here's an idea. Ask them to hop on one foot. If they're new to this planet, they might not be used to our gravity. Great idea.
Of course, the science teacher will have none of this. This is serious science time, not taking the topic and giving it a fun twist that'll make it engaging and relatable time. So, will the two kids compromise, get good grades, and avoid summer school, or will they stay true to their vision? And just what is Joe Jones's deal anyway? Space Geeks and Johnny Unitas is rarely on anyone's top 10 Pete and Pete episodes list, and the impression I get from waiting in internet discussions is that people find it middling at best.
What do you want from a wiper like Porchman?
An A.
I'd take a B minus.
But I think that has less to do with the episode's own qualities and more with how amazing the rest of the show is. This has pretty much all the elements that make the Pete and Pete franchise so special and engaging. Three pillars that uphold the series as a unique work. Perception, the significance of insignificant things, and empathy. Human perception is not consistent. Time seems to compress or dilate depending on things like focus, mood, external factors like temperature, and age. Children and young adults really do perceive the world differently from grown-ups. There are two main reasons for this. One is scale. The older you are, the less significant a period of time is. When you turn 30, you're only 3% older than you were a year ago. When you turn 8, you're 12.5% older than you were a year ago. A shorter period of time has larger significance to you when you're younger. The second reason is biological. Young children have faster average heart rates than adults, faster rates of breathing, faster metabolisms, and some have theorized faster brain functions. Some have hypothesized that the rate in which we process visual information slows down over time. People are often amazed at how much they remember from days that seem to last forever in their youth. It's not that their experiences were much deeper or more meaningful, it's just that they were being processed in rapid fire. And this is just our perception of time. Perception is different in just about every way when you're a kid. When you're smaller, the world seems bigger. When you're 6, a 12-year-old looks grown up. And when you're 18, a 12-year-old looks like a little kid. Pete and Pete use these manipulations of perception to create a sort of liminal space out of childhood, a world that is familiar but weird in a way that is hard to pin down. This special specifically is bookended on how time seems to slow down when you approach the end of a school year.
I'm not sure what the astrophysical formula is, but every summer, as the Earth's equator tilts further and further away from the sun, the days get longer and longer, and somehow, it seems as if the minutes and seconds get longer too. Especially when you're counting down the last week of school. Just ask my brother Pete. Time simply slows down.
Fight my scab!
Then there's the significance of insignificant things. Have you ever become hyper-fixated on something and realized you're probably the only one at school interested in it? Maybe you're the only one who thinks the stone protectors are better than the Ninja Turtles. Maybe you found a book of poetry at the library from an obscure local poet and you have nobody to talk about it with. Maybe you just really, really, really want to find Bigfoot. Pete and Pete embraces these connections we make with obscurities, ephemera, and kitsch. Big Pete is really into Johnny Unitas, a football player that was already retired when he was born, and a specific football game that historically put the NFL on the map and started its upwards trajectory to the biggest sport in the United States, but happened more than 30 years ago.
My friends, who are fans of superstars like Randall Cunningham, think I have brain damage. I tried showing them the picture that started my worship of Johnny U.
Pete, the guy's not even in color.
But somehow, I don't think they fully understood his majestic splendor. I don't know. Every time I look at it, I see a man who played each game as if the fate of the entire universe depended on him and him alone.
Even the people who played in the game don't feel it's that big a deal. But Big Pete finds it a transcendent moment. In an objective, uncaring universe, all things are insignificant, really. Significance is something we as people attach to things, and forging your own connection to something, to deem it significant to you, is kind of beautiful. Finally, there's empathy. Pete and Pete is known for its eccentric characters, oddballs and weirdos existing in the margins of society. And one of the show's best tricks, one they go to quite a bit, is taking what appear to be joke characters and giving them interior space, fleshing them out into actual people who want the same human connections we all want. A reoccurring plot for the show has one or both of the Petes realizing this, extending empathy to these characters, and becoming friends. The weirdo this time around is Joe Jones, a quiet little nerd who seems to have innate static cling and a cowlick that points magnetic north. In actuality, Joe Jones is an alien, but you can't just say that. If you say you're an alien, then you become the pretends to be an alien guy. Joe Jones has to get Big Pete and Ellen to understand the idea before coming out. He does this in two ways, by finding common ground with Big Pete over the football game, which Joe Jones actually watched as the signal reached his planet, and by helping Ellen develop the test to identify aliens. He wanted them to understand ahead of time that he wasn't human, but he was most definitely a person.
Joe answered all our questions about where he came from and how he got here. And then, he answered the hardest question of all.
If he didn't want us to find out about you, why did you get us started on this whole alien search? I was lonely, I guess. Until that day at the planetarium, you guys wouldn't even go near me. I was a nobody. But then everything changed. We were a team. I didn't want it to end, but I knew it had to. Sooner or later, you'd find out what I really was. I think we figured out what you were about 2 days ago.
You did?
Yep. A friend.
It's not the best version of this idea the show pulled off, but the fact that they did this kind of thing multiple times means it was an idea the show wanted to reinforce. We all experience the world differently. We all care about different things. But we're not actually all that different, not in the ways that matter. The Adventures of Pete and Pete is such a wonderful human tapestry, and I can't wait to talk about it more. Because this was just a sample.